This video was made possible by CuriosityStream. Watch thousands of high-quality documentaries and get access to my streaming service Nebula using the link in the description. In the 1950s, this is the pride of the Soviet Union. A sleek new airliner, one of the first ever to be powered by jets. It flies faster, further, and is a showcase of Soviet technology. But there's something wrong with this plane, because over the course of a few months, airliners just like this one have been involved in a truly bizarre string of incidents. These planes aren't just crashing, they're being thrown up into the sky, sometimes by several thousand feet, leaving investigators racing for answers. The 1950s saw the start of a boom in commercial air travel. Flying had become safer, faster, and more comfortable. And those who had the means could now cross entire continents in just hours or travel halfway around the world in less than a day. Air travel had entered a golden age, at least in the Western world, because over in the Soviet Union, flying was radically different. Soviet airliners were at least a generation or two behind Western designs. They were slower, smaller, and offered little in the way of comfort. Even worse, they couldn't fly very far. And in a country as massive as the Soviet Union, that was a problem. Because flying across the country from Moscow to Vladivostok meant having to stop to refuel at least 6 times. The trip could take as long as 50 hours. And it was made even more grueling aboard cramped and noisy aircraft that couldn't fly high enough to avoid rough weather. In the early 1950s, the Soviet Union was in desperate need of a new modern airliner. But rather than just catching up to the West, they were about to make a massive gamble on a new technology. In 1952, the British stunned the world by introducing the first ever jet-powered airliner. The de Havilland Comet flew nearly twice as fast as any airliner before it, and 15,000 feet higher. Developing it had been a massive effort requiring years of research and development. And while jet engines were still relatively new and unproven, many could see that they were the next evolution in air travel, including one famous aircraft designer from the Soviet Union named Andrei Tupolev, who saw them as a way to bring Soviet air travel into the future. A jet airliner like the Comet could cut flying times down by a third and enable air travel on a mass scale. The problem was Soviet leadership saw jets as unreliable, fuel-thirsty, and expensive, an excess better left to greedy Western capitalists. What's more, the Comet had taken the better part of 10 years and millions to develop, time and resources that Soviet leaders weren't eager to invest. But knowing this, Tupolev had a plan. He promised top Soviet brass that he could build them a jet in just 3 years, a reliable jet airliner with even more passenger capacity than the Comet, built at a fraction of the cost. What's more, a Soviet-designed jet airliner would prove to the world that the Soviet Union was every bit as advanced as the West. It was an offer they couldn't refuse. But how do you build a state-of-the-art jet airliner like the Comet in just 3 years? Well, you start with a massive shortcut. This is the Tu-16 bomber, built to rain havoc over Europe, and for Tupolev, the basis of his new airliner. Having just finished designing it for the Soviet Air Force, Tupolev figured he was already halfway there. He'd just need to widen the fuselage. But he could keep the engines, even if they weren't the most efficient and a little loud. He could also reuse the wings. Although better suited for high-speed bombing runs, it would save engineering time. The pilots might just have to land a little faster. Same concept for the tail and vertical stabilizer. They could largely be reused. Landing gear, avionics, and other components could also be plucked right off the bomber's assembly line. The heavy-duty military components would add up to nearly 100,000 pounds, making for one sturdy airliner. Designed in record time and built at a fraction of the cost, Tupolev would name the new airliner as the Tu-104. While Tupolev was putting the finishing touches on his new plane, it was becoming apparent that the transition to jet travel wouldn't be so straightforward. By 1954, design flaws in the Comet caused a series of tragic crashes, which ultimately led to the aircraft's grounding. The Comet was banned from commercial flights for 4 years while investigators sorted out the issues. It meant, by the time the Soviet Union's new jet airliner made its first test flight in June of 1955, the Soviets suddenly found themselves with the world's only operational jet airliner. But rather than take it as a sign of caution, they jumped on the propaganda opportunity. While the 104 was still undergoing flight testing in 1956, a delegation of Soviet leaders flew to Britain aboard the new plane. The rakish-looking airliner caught many off guard. Aviation experts and British news reporters, still reeling from the Comet's grounding, were kicked into a frenzy. The press were convinced that the Soviets had leapfrogged years ahead of the West with a much larger and technologically superior design. For the Soviets, it was a propaganda windfall, and it wouldn't be the last time they showed off the new jet. Over the coming months, 104s visited cities across Europe, each time crowds greeted the aircraft, and dignitaries were given an opportunity to marvel at Soviet technology. In 1957, a 104 even showed up to the Paris Air Show, marking the first ever appearance by a non-Western-built aircraft. A few months later, the new airliner flew all the way to the United States for another state visit, marking the first ever transatlantic crossing by a jet airliner. For the Soviets, the 104 was a huge propaganda win, and quickly developing it out of a bomber seemed like a masterstroke of genius. But the first signs of trouble were already beginning to appear. Compared to other airliners, the Tu-104 was a handful to fly. Pilots complained about heavy, unresponsive controls, and the aircraft's enormous weight and highly swept wings made low-speed flying particularly challenging. Landing at busy civilian airports was a white-knuckle affair. Pilots were so afraid of stalling, it was common practice to land the plane at higher speeds than designed. Stopping was another issue. The airliner had no air brakes, no thrust reversers, and a weak set of wheel brakes. A hastily deployed parachute was often the only thing that kept the airliner from continuing past the runway. But the complaints were brushed off by Soviet authorities. That is, until 1958, when the airliner began exhibiting behaviors that were impossible to ignore. The first sign of trouble came in February, when a CSA-104 flew into turbulence, which caused both engines to flame out. Without power, the aircraft fell 20,000 feet before the frantic pilots managed to relight the engines. A month later, another 104 ran into turbulent weather, but this time the aircraft was hurled up into the sky, and the pilots couldn't stop it from climbing, all the way up to 44,000 feet, higher than the plane should ever fly. Eventually, the aircraft stalled and began tumbling back to Earth before the pilots managed to regain control. Despite the near disasters, Soviet authorities were quick to blame the pilots. But the incidents continued. In August, another 104 was mysteriously hurled up into the sky. Again, the aircraft stalled, but this time the pilots couldn't recover, and tragically, there were no survivors. Just 2 months later, a 104 flying between Beijing and Moscow was once again hurled up into the sky. This time, the pilot heroically radioed back details as they were happening. While he couldn't save the aircraft, the information radioed back would prove pivotal. Authorities could no longer ignore the bizarre series of accidents. There was clearly something wrong with the plane. But remarkably, they wouldn't ground the aircraft, instead letting it continue carrying passengers while they were still working to uncover the mystery. Eventually, investigators would come to realize that the cause was powerful updrafts that the pilots couldn't counteract, and the aircraft's bomber-derived origins were at least partly to blame. The 104's larger pressurized cabin was prone to having its center of gravity shifted rearward, depending on how the aircraft was loaded. This meant that there was a natural tendency to pitch upwards in an updraft, and the aircraft wasn't powerful enough to counteract these forces, leaving the pilots helpless. A number of emergency modifications were made, and the aircraft was restricted from flying above a certain altitude. But not before another incident in 1959, when another 104 hit an updraft before the pilots managed to recover. A critical design flaw had cost 144 lives. And although fixes were made, the aircraft would still go on to earn an extensive rap sheet of other accidents. The most common were runway overshoots, thanks to the tricky nature of flying the heavy bomber-derived airliner. Nearly one out of every five Tu-104 that was built would end up destroyed in accidents. But given the secretive nature of the Soviet Union, these incidents received little news coverage. Even so, the airliner developed a notorious reputation amongst the traveling public, even becoming the theme of a 1960s folk song. Ту-104 – самый лучший самолет. За пять минут вас в могилу довезет. Like the British, the Soviets paid heavily for pioneering jet travel. But by 1958, the Comet had been heavily redesigned and was back in service, and the Americans had introduced their own jet airliner. Any propaganda value the 104 once had was gone. But the Soviet Union's first jet airliner played a vital role in modernizing air travel inside the country. To accommodate the jet, air traffic control systems were modernized, new terminals were built, and runways throughout the Soviet Union were lengthened. And the operational lessons learned from the 104 would help pave the way for future Soviet airliners, earning the 104 a spot amongst the world's pioneering aircraft. I've been busy working on my most ambitious video yet, on the story of the most advanced aircraft ever built, the Northrop B-2 Spirit. I covered the mysterious plane's Cold War origins, the controversy surrounding its development, and why, 40 years on, it remains the world's most feared bomber. What started out as any other mustard video has grown to become my biggest project yet, and the video I've invested the most energy into. I'll be releasing it December 16th on Nebula. Nebula is where you can watch exclusive mustard videos, like the story of the MiG-31 Interceptor, the legendary F-117 Nighthawk, and the M-50 Bounder, along with lesser-known bizarre proposals like the MiG-25 business jet and the insane Soviet plan for flying aircraft carriers. Nebula is where you'll find hundreds of other exclusives from great independent creators like Real Life Lore, Wendover, and Real Engineering. On Nebula, there's no algorithm that punishes creators for trying something new or taking risks on big-budget projects. And because Nebula is completely ad-free, creators aren't limited to making content that YouTube deems advertiser-friendly. The best part about Nebula is that it's free when you sign up for CuriosityStream, a streaming service featuring thousands of award-winning documentaries. A recent favorite of mine is Gander International, a fascinating documentary chronicling the story behind a remote northern airport, which was once one of the most important in the world. Get unlimited access to both CuriosityStream and Nebula for just a little over a dollar a month by going to curiositystream.com/mustard and use the promo code MUSTARD when you sign up.